Radical Happiness, Moments of Collective Joy is a 2017 work by the Australian feminist Lynn Sagal. Born in New South Wales in 1944, Sagal studied psychology at Sydney University and gained a PhD in 1969. She moved to Britain in 1970 and taught in higher education for a while before gaining a lectureship at Middlesex Polytechnic in 1973, then a professorship at Birkbeck in 1999, where she still works. Which only tells half the story, however. As a teenager, she joined a small group of anarchists called The Push. In England, she helped set up a women's centre in Islington and part-founded a left-wing newspaper, all the time advocating an inclusive form of feminism that resisted the conflation by some feminists of male sexuality and male violence. Her first book is The Future Female, published in 1987, took issue with thinkers such as Andrea Dworkin and Mary Daly for espousing a rigidly essentialist view of the sexes. In some ways, Radical Happiness could be read as a companion volume to Barbara Ehrenreich's 2007 Dancing in the Streets, but Sagal is less concerned with the broad sweep of history, focusing instead on events since the rise of modern capitalism. When she does consider the Ehrenreich text in Chapter 3, she sets it in the context of the philosophy of the Russian thinker Mikhail Bakhtin, whom Ehrenreich mentions only in passing. What emerges is an illuminating discussion. The book begins by discussing happiness and joy, which Sagal thinks must be considered as political rather than as purely personal concepts. The recent interest in happiness shown by both governments and employers, she says in Chapter 1, have been triggered not by outbursts of benevolence towards us, quite the contrary. The disingenuous happiness agenda is concerned above all with softening the costs of ever-rising social wretchedness. Ultimately, Radical Happiness endorses the position of the 20th century German-American thinker Hannah Arendt, whom Sagal reminds us argued that no one could be called happy or free without participating in and having a share in public power. What Arendt held dear was the power that arises out of joint action and deliberation. What makes this such an impressive book is partly its scope. While Sagal can sometimes seem to be taking a detour, a little thought always shows why she's going in that particular direction. She doesn't talk down to the reader, nor does she assume that the reader is as well-read as she obviously is. Thinkers and movements are always put explicitly in their social and historical contexts, and our writing style is clear. Along the way, we get a short history of second wave feminism, partly as a way of picking apart the potential of romantic love as a source of joy. Then a consideration of the value of utopian thinking. She agrees with the contemporary political philosopher David Leopold that we need more. Plus, in the last chapter, a critical survey of post-war Britain to the present day, where she's particularly scathing of successive governments' efforts to outsource essential services and the corruption that's caused. It's difficult nowadays to write a book about happiness, particularly its political dimension, not least because, as Sagal herself points out at the start, contemporary Western culture has demoted it to the status of a purely private concern. This book is a robust attempt to reset the agenda, and at bottom it's optimistic. The author thinks we're capable of much, much better. I hope she's right, but that's the virtue of a book like this. You don't have to hope. You can consider the arguments. Over to you.